Revenge, how you doing? Welcome to Community Crossfire, another point of view. I'm your host, Stormin Norman Oliver, the most talked about, the most interesting TV show on DETV. This show is really taking off. As you see, last week we had someone from the UK. We had people from Belgium. Yes, we're going international. This show is so hot, we like on fire. But before I begin with my guests, these guys are friends, really, really good friends, right? These guys, I think, are phenomenal people, and I'm going to introduce them in a minute. I want to talk a little bit about last week's show. A lot of people called and texted me about my brother Rob, who I didn't know, didn't realize, you know, it's kind of strange. And so many people were intrigued by that interview, and he was in tears. And I just want to thank everyone for their calls and just everything. It was just phenomenal. I want to talk a little bit about what's happening in our country. First of all, I want to congratulate the winners in Georgia. I think that's going to help our president, Joe Biden, out tremendously. What an incredible show of force in Georgia. I read a book like 20 years ago. It's called The Good Black. It's about a guy. He was a lawyer. He was a black lawyer. He went to Harvard Law School. And he's like, I'm not getting the black student union. I'm not joining the fraternity. I'm not joining, like, I'm not anything, right? Dealing with anything black. He's black, right? And so he goes on and gets into a law firm. Now it comes a time where he's become, you know, tenure, you know, whatever, when you become in the legal field, right? And they said, no, you're not going to be this guy in a law firm. So he ended up suing. So I guess the moral of the story is he played the game to go into the white world, right? And when he got there, did not know you're not going to be a partner. And because I'm crazy, I find a guy, Larry Moon. I called him over the weekend, right? And got him on the phone. How you do that, right? I'm like, he's Storm.
Because you're
Norm. Because I'm Storm, right?
That's right.
And he gets on the phone and he's like, hello. You know, he's selling real estate now in Virginia somewhere. And I said, are you the Larry from the book, The Good Black? He said, yeah. You know, he thinks he's selling me a house. I'll get him a finger, but he's not going to sell me a house. But he didn't want to get into it. But I mean, it's this the kind of quality of people that we're trying to bring on the show. So welcome, Chris Buccini. How you doing, my friend?
We're doing good, Norm. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, how you doing?
Honored to be here.
Yeah, I'm honored too, man. How you doing, Rob?
I'm good, Norm. Always good.
So
to see you.
I've known these guys for over 20 years, 25 years. These guys, I think, are phenomenal guys. I think what they're doing for our city is phenomenal. And I'm going to ask you guys in your own way, right? We did an interview like 10 years ago, but we did it like on the street corner somewhere. And now we're moving up like the Jeffersons, right? You know, a lot is talked about, right? A lot is spoken about both you guys, right? Could you guys tell our viewing audience a little bit about your story? I mean, we don't have to get too deep, right? But I think I've heard it, and I think it's intriguing. Like, I think people somehow get a notion that you guys walked into Wilmington, somebody gave you $1 billion, and you had to do nothing. I'm being real serious about this, right?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Chris will answer it, but Norm, you're right. Like, you know, all the time, people are like, wait, you grew up here? You're from the city of Wilmington? And I'm like, yeah. And I think that, you know, people that don't know us, you know, have an impression and, you know, may formulate a view that, you know, it's just based on, you know, hearsay. And I think the people that know us, which is the vast majority of people, obviously growing up here in Delaware, have really, really, you know, have great dealings and overall respect for us. But, you know, Chris is always good. He's a little smarter than I am. Got into Princeton. I didn't. So he can.
He likes to drop the work on me. No, but I think the story is, you know, our grandparents are Italian immigrants, and our grandfather, Ed DeSeta, came over when he was 15, literally without shoes. And he grew up in the St. Anthony's neighborhood, Little Italy neighborhood of Wilmington. And so we grew up the grandchildren of immigrants who came to Delaware, and they were in the construction business. And after college, Rob and I went to New York because we wanted to get into real estate. And we always have this draw very quickly in our 20s to come back to Wilmington because we saw growth happening in all these other cities in America. And we kept saying, well, why not Wilmington? Mm. And I think it was just in our DNA. Our family grew up at 5th and DuPont Street. And that's where we grew up. That's where we spent our afternoons with our grandmother and our aunts. And so it was just very natural for us to come back. And we always say we just really, our goal is to have Wilmington be the best version of itself.
You know, and I'm glad you said that, Chris. Of course, I like to get into really deep discussions. Like, do you guys, I mean, we're going to talk about development. We're going to talk about the field house and buying and all that kind of stuff. But do you get a little frustrated sometimes, right? Some of the conversations, I mean, it got to get to you. Like, the mayor's giving you this, or the governor's giving you that, you know, the Buccini guys get every freaking thing. Right?
Sometimes, you know, someone will come up and say that to you, or someone will tell you, oh, that person, you know, down the way said, you know, took a shot at you.
It's in the paper.
It's in the paper. You know, the paper obviously is often. And I think a couple things. One, as you probably realized over the last several years, I think the complaints the thought that we've been, you know, given the easy road, this definitely diminished a little bit. I think, you know, more people now, as we've done more and more, and you see the body of work or said, okay, these guys do what they say they're going to do. And you know, Norman, I think, you know, no one's going to outwork us. There's people that are a lot smarter than us, you know, that have better capital. But, you know, what we learned from our parents and you know this, I mean, you go down on A Street, 7 days a week, their cars are in the parking lot. And I think that was one of the greatest things that we learned. And then, you know, we played sports growing up here in the city. So when you play sports and you play three sports, you play year round, you know, you're playing, you know, and I was an all-state. I love to say this all the time to you, Norman. I was an all-state football player 2 years in a row.
35
you know,
years ago.
Longer than that. You know, I peaked when I was, you know, 17 and 18. But I think, you know people when you're playing at the – working at Downtown Y, you're playing at, you know, one of the Boys and Girls Clubs, you know, people know you in the community and they know how you're a competitor. And so I think all that stuff has been really helpful as we've done work in the city to, you know, move it forward. You know, the 76ers Fieldhouse, I think, is one of the greatest examples of our passion. So,
And we're going to talk about that. Let's stay right here for one second, Rob. Let's go back to 2008, Chris, when things got really rough, right?
Real rough, right?
What did you go through and what went through your mind?
Well, you know, I think the best.
Because people, it was crashing then.
The best thing that happened to us was we started in our 20s when we didn't know any better, right? Mm-hmm. So we took some big risks at a young age and we just didn't know any better. We were somewhat fearless. And for the most part, things have worked out, but we've definitely had, you know, huge challenges along the way. 2008 was the big one. We were in our late 30s. So it was the body of work that we had done in early to mid 30s. And I'll never forget, you know, going to my mom's office and saying, Mom, things are going to get really, really bad here. This is like 07, 08. We just saw, you know, Lehman coming. And my mom said, good, you got to learn how to suffer.
Wow.
And so there was no hug or don't worry, you'll be fine. She said,
so
good.
She said, you got to learn how to suffer.
Yeah, she said, you know, she's old school Italian Catholic. You got to suffer. And so literally we put together a bit of a playbook of how we're going to make it through the next 4 years. And every day we came in as a team. And as Rob said, we're all, you know, a lot of us played sports and there's very little ego in our office. And we came together as a company, as a team. And every day we just fought harder and harder, harder, and we came stronger. And I'll never forget, you know, Market Street, you know, really trying to bring Market Street back to life a little bit. Because as you'll remember, a lot of Market Street was shut down. Until 10 years ago.
A lot of it was dead.
It was
68 vacant buildings we bought.
Literally 68 vacant. Buildings. And I'll never forget.
68 vacant buildings.
Vacant buildings. 68. Not one, the 69th had a ground floor tenant. But, you know, I remember we were begging Norman, and I want to digress, the Blessing Place. Remember the Blessing Place and Dell State? We're begging these people to stay. And they're just packing
keep
up.
Anyway.
I remember you jumped off the board because of that.
Rob interjected on me. But I'll never forget telling Governor Markell at that point, we'd spent a lot of blood, sweat, and tears on Market Street and saying, you know, we're in the deepest of that recession. We said we're more committed to really lifting up our community than we ever were. So
but Norman, like, you know, I would, you know, Norman, we talk 6 in the morning, some morning, 6:30.
Yeah.
Usually I see if it's 6:15, it's Norman in the morning. And Norman, remember that I'm like, Norman, this is, you know, terrifying. Like, you know, weeks without sleep. You know, we were working 20 hours a day to navigate it because all of our partners were going out of business. You know, the banks were going out of business. You know, what you told what happened, remember Wilmington Trust, who we were a small customer of, and, you know, the big customers of ours were going out of business. People weren't paying their rent. So, you know, and again, I think it goes back to our the way we were raised, right? It goes back to, you know, how tough your mother is. Right. My mother had me when she turned 21. She had me on a Sunday. She was on unemployment, but she had a job, right? And she went to work on Wednesday, right? So she had me on a Sunday at the Wilmington Hospital. Wednesday, she had to go and do payroll.
Well, the reason
and
why,
so that's the, I think that's the grit that I think embodies our company.
The
right
reason
there.
Why I wanted to just bring up that because people look at the glamour, right? Like there's
what glamour?
Well, I mean, be honest, right? They look at the riverfront, right? Because that's all we've spoken about, right?
Yeah, yeah.
They look at downtown. We talked about Market Street. Yeah. So it's like there's no like you guys have no pain. Like everything, like Alan and I gives you breaks. The mayor gives you break. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean. I can't be the only guy who hears this.
Yeah, no, for sure. You know, and our obviously retort is, listen, you know, we're under the microscope. So, you know, I think there's a double standard. And our standard, I will tell anyone in the city, is usually higher just because of the scrutiny that we get. And as you know, and I think the mayor addressed this, you know, under, you know, the Williams administration, it was a, you know, in terms of investment in our projects, you know, Dennis, who, you know, I had a good relationship with, you know, we were able to get a bigger actual cash investment with under the Williams administration, the Baker and the Sills than under Przycki. Przycki, you know, the Norm and I, we joke about this. They made one capital investment and that was in the field house. And, you know, look how unbelievable
and
that was. And that was basically the permit fee that got rebated.
So what would you guys' portfolio be like right now? I mean, what do you have? Let's say downtown Wilmington.
Right.
Wilmington, Delaware. How much have you guys invested?
And, you know, Norm, the thing is, you know, we're invested in New York City and Philly and Baltimore and Nashville and all these New Orleans, all these other cities around the country. And we always say that's sort of like our investment portfolio, but Wilmington's where our heart and soul is. And we keep sort of reinvesting in the city.
What do you think you have invested here money-wise?
Billion and a half.
A billion? Ladies and gentlemen, a billion and a half and you're crying. Suppose they took this to another city, right?
And you know, we're also bringing in out-of-state lenders, out-of-state investors. We're really getting people to believe in Wilmington and the Wilmington story. And so I think our passion for the city is what helps us attract this billion-dollar plus investment over 20 years.
That's great. If you had to look back, right, what would you say was like all in Wilmington, like, oh, we did it. Would that be 76ers?
You know.
Or like one of your first projects, like the Nemours building?
There are two projects that.
Is there any time that you guys just went, let's high five, yo, we kicked butt on it.
Yeah, but it's not what you might think,
well,
right?
Well, I'll tell you, last year, the beginning of 2020, we're like, wow, we really have turned the corner here in the city in terms of economic development. People were moving here easily into the apartments. Companies were relocating. And then we obviously got hit by the pandemic. So really, end of 2019, Chris, and early 2020, we felt like, wow, it's the first time we had our wind at the backs.
In 20 years, we started in 1999.
Yeah, and you're just
and
like,
20 years later,
finally,
2019,
finally.
We finally felt like there was a little bit of wind at our back.
Yeah.
And what I'm going to say is, you know, I think if you really look at the first 10 years versus the last 10 years, the first 10 years we were doing office buildings, right? And started apartments and we were sort of like trying to bring businesses here. The last 10 years, we're really trying to get people to live in the city of Wilmington, have fun in the city of Wilmington, stay here nights and weekends. We're creating a lot of jobs for people that aren't, you know, credit card people and lawyers. They're people that are more from the community. But I think the thing that I will be the most, humbled by, proud of, is bringing ShopRite to the riverfront. And people don't understand the magnitude. I remember living in New York City, and when the grocery store went to 125th Street in Harlem, it was national news, right? And so we put the biggest grocery store in the state of Delaware right in the middle of a food desert. And so we were giving people from Southbridge, which, you know, we had our offices there for a long time, we were giving them access to, you know, reasonably priced food, fresh food. So I think we went in.
But also at the same time, providing, you know, that's the same offerings to all the tenants, that residents and businesses that live on the riverfront. So, but Chris would say to us early on, you know, in the 2000s, you know, we get disappointed, like, wow, there's not more people staying after work, like it's 5 o'clock. You know, which is true. There's nothing to do.
And weekends.
And I remember one of the low points was, you know, we did the partnership with Zanzibar Blue and the Brandywine building. It was an unbelievable space.
Yeah.
Great, great operators, the Bynum brothers, great food, unbelievable music. And it was just before our time. We didn't have that residential base.
But you guys had the vision. I loved it down there.
And it was, remember how awesome it was? We, you know, well, actually, remember our first meeting with Mike Brown, who was about to become a councilman, then was there in one of the booths.
But Rob, what else were you, I mean, what else do you think? Like, what project?
You know, certainly when we did the Delaware Trust building renovation, we took down the tower and we made that into residential.
That thing was so cool. Especially when you first opened, you had the guy outside.
That took some courage because that was a big boy project at a time where, you know, we had really limited capital. And the fact that we were able to take the tower down, build the building back up, you know, and come in on a budget. And then we have, I think, 500 people live in that building. And the fact that we were able to then, you know, ask people and people actually live there, enjoy living there, I think that was really big. And that really was solidified the downtown area to be a complement to the riverfront.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're looking at Community Crossfire, Another Point of View. I'm your host with the Buccini Brothers. What a fascinating conversation. Let me ask you guys a couple of questions, right? Because we got to move on at some point. But when you hear people saying you guys are gentrifying the community, that's another, I mean, some stuff I don't know. I want you guys to talk in your own word. What do you think of that?
Well, I think, you know, a lot of times people, and I'm guilty of this, I'm a hometown person, right? I'm not traveling a ton, especially in COVID. So you don't go out and don't see how other of your peer cities are progressing, then, you know, if this is built or if this investment's made or this park is renovated, you know, there's just a fear of uncertainty, right? So gentrification, part of means that you actually are displacing people. Right. So one of the great things about building in downtown Wilmington is every building was vacant, right? Literally, there was a huge sucking sound. People moved to Middletown. The malls were built. You know, there was, 1968, you know, the civil unrest. And you know, I-95 was built down the middle of the city. You know, so there's terrible things that happened and just caused the city to literally move. So when we were, you know, buying buildings, the only tenant of the 69 buildings that we moved out was Kennedy Fried Chicken, and their lease had expired. They just didn't want to leave. Donald Trump. They were supposed to be out of the building, and they still were there, right? And so you're like, hey. And we took a reporter from the News Journal into the Queen when it was completely vacant. I mean, dead pigeons everywhere. It must have been 100 dead pigeons leaking.
It had been shut down since 1958.
Yeah. And they're like, why are you going to renovate this? This is such a gorgeous structure. And we're looking at each other.
There was
other
a colored,
like,
last time it was open, there was a colored section.
Which was the mezzanine.
That's how long it had been.
I did not know that. Ladies and gentlemen, you're getting the history here.
Yeah. And which is, you know, unbelievable that now you have Kamala based out of there.
Right, I just want to say, you know, so like when people, like, we almost have to like laugh when, because of the, we've probably bought we have bought over 50 buildings or parcels of land. Every single, this is the riverfront. These are all the DuPont buildings. These buildings were either vacant or it was environmentally contaminated land. So we brought back vacant buildings that were empty and they weren't producing any tax revenue. We spent, as you know, over $1 billion fixing these up and creating a huge tax base for the city that goes to the whole city. Yeah, I mean, it's a pretty incredible story.
Right.
And our tax revenue, say it's $10 million a year that we pay to the city through, you know, real estate taxes, permit fees, you know, wage tax, like that's $10 million that the residents of the city don't have to pay. You know, so you're, you know, it's material amount of money. The other thing, Norman, is just think, like, if we didn't do the Queen and renovate Market Street and didn't do the riverfront, like, where would Joe Biden be and Kamala Harris be accepting this and having their headquarters? Could be in Philadelphia. Like, it would be at the Constitution Center,
perhaps. It's funny you bring that up, Rob. I'm sure people who are watching want to hear about the riverfront because they associate you guys with the riverfront. Let's talk a little about the riverfront, how you guys got down there and got into the development, because wasn't that the other guy, the other development?
Petnero, right? Absolutely.
And then it was the Muslim guy who owned a lot of stuff down there, right? So how did you guys get into...
Actually, Rob, let me start with this, because in 1999, we started buying buildings from the DuPont building right in the... I call it the CBD, the central business, right around Rodney Square. And we started building apartments. People started coming to downtown Wilmington. And after like a year, they're like, we want to live downtown, but there's nothing to do. Mm-hmm. And then we realized there was other stuff going on the riverfront, but we were like basically 10 blocks from the riverfront. Right. And so then Rob on the riverfront.
So, if you remember, AIG was going to build two office buildings on the site which Christina Landing sits. Right. So there's a big announcement, I think, and then they subsequently bought another insurance company called, I think it was called American General. So the two office buildings that were about to start construction on, and you know, that Sammy Congo on the land, RDC bought it from, I think, Sammy, or the state did, and getting ready to start construction, the deal got put on hold because of the merger of AIG Life Insurance. So on hold, so Mike Przycki at the time called me, and you know, we had just finished the development of the residence at Rodney Square, the former Delaware Trust building, and I didn't know Mike. Like, you know, everyone thinks, you know, I've known Mike forever.
Right.
I didn't know Mike. And I remember asking Bo Biden the night before, I said, Bo, I have a meeting with Mike Przycki. What's he like? And Bo said, you know, I don't know him that well, but he's best friends with his brother, Joe. And he said, that says a lot. And, you know, Bo being best friends with Hunt, you know, Chris and I being best friends and working together, you know, as you know, we're super tight with Bo and Hunt since we were 6 years old. That was my really... That's how I knew Mike going to the meeting, like that Bo thought he was a good guy because he was best friends with his brother.
This is a really fascinating conversation. How many people do you guys think you employ in the city of Wilmington?
Chris?
About 850, 900 downtown Wilmington.
Yeah. So ladies and gentlemen,
the city, yeah,
put
the
this
city
in perspective, right?
Super diverse.
Perspective, right? At one point, it was the DuPont company was the biggest employers, right? Then at one point, it was Bank of America, MBNA. Yeah. I think you guys are the biggest employers.
Well, and by the way,
Chase would be definitely far bigger than us.
But I mean, but you're in the conversation.
But we're in the conversation. But more importantly, we're really proud of the jobs we've created, right? So we've created jobs that otherwise wouldn't exist.
Gotcha.
You know, the people that are, you know, working at the sports facility or Penn Cinema or the ShopRite or Deco or the hotel,
the hotels.
These are all new jobs to downtown that a lot of people that within the community can work at. And these are jobs that didn't exist.
How did that Sixer thing even come about?
How the Sixers?
Yeah. I mean,
How
do you get to Sixers?
I told Rob he was crazy.
You know, my good friend Elton Brand. I love saying that.
I love every conversation.
My good friend Elton Brand. No, I joke with Elton.
You and Dr. J, you know.
I said, Elton, Wilmington, we made you. And, you know, he said, you know, he's such a modest guy. Didn't have anything to do with his first pick out of Duke. Or,
right, right.
Like he's what, make $200 million in career earnings. So at the time, the Sixers were looking to relocate to Wilmington from University of Delaware. You know, it was hard scheduling with all the other people that were there.
Right.
And Governor Arkell had been working with the Sixers president and, you know, Scott O'Neill, the CEO, Chris Heck, the president, they're all Wilmington, you know, based people. And they were put in contact with us. And then we started doing some due diligence. John Carney became the governor. And fortunately, he's a huge sports guy. He gets the importance of youth sports. He gets the importance of just sports in general in our community and hometown pride. And then we knew that Nemours was looking to put a medical office in the city. They wanted to be, you know, outside the walls of their building. And then through the Reeder boys, you know, Troy and Kobe and their dad, Dan Reeder, we got to know the guys at Titus. And so between the Reeder boys, you know, being really phenomenal athletes down at the one location that they still have in Newark at Titus, between our relationship with Nemours and the government putting us in touch with the Sixers, we were able to get those three anchor tenants together.
Phenomenal story.
Yeah. And then, you know, we started, that was the anchor tenants that allowed us to finance the complex. And you know, now you go down there.
I was amazed at all the black and brown people in there working.
It is.
But you know, Wilmington's a small city, right?
Right.
And so to do anything big, and that's a big project.
That's big.
You've got to be a convener. And so what Rob did unbelievably well on that project was he was able to convene people over years.
Convener, you know, you were conveners, you know, so we
But he literally
watch out for your jargon, man. You know,
you don't learn that at Cornell dorm.
Yeah, he brought Sixers. He brought Titus. He brought
that's cool.
He brought AI DePond, and by bringing
you got a soccer
together,
stadium down there too, right?
We have an outdoor soccer field, and we just and to show you how I think kudos to the staff down at the field house, the operations team down there. We went to city council right before the end of the year. We want to expand the complex by two fields on land that the city owns. We'd obviously pay for the land and through a long-term lease, and we'd spend all the money with a not-for-profit called FSS. We got 12 votes, 12 votes to zero, and everyone on city council voted in favor of moving forward to expand the complex down there.
And
so it just shows you the impact that we've had, not on sports, but also on the community. And listen, it's a really big thing for hometown pride.
Oh,
I mean,
it's
you know, we've done so many national broadcasts out of there, you know, Wilmington, Delaware.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And now, you know, the Biden campaign is trying to steal our thunder with all the Wilmington, Delaware.
So let's move up. Now we're in COVID, right?
Yeah.
Which is one of the most pandemic, the worst pandemic to ever hit the world, right?
Right.
How did you guys manage that? And did you have to lay off a lot of people? Or how are you dealing with it now?
Sure.
I mean, you know, a lot of people in business and not in business wanted me to ask you guys this question,
yeah,
right?
Sure.
How did that affect your business and the businesses that you're dealing with? Because it looked like a store or two closed because of the pandemic downtown.
Well, I think first, you know, I think Rob and I are by nature, our leadership style is to lead from the front, mm-hmm. right? So that's just the way we run BPG. And I think that's the right way we want. So we really wanted to be out there in front for, you know, we've all of our office tenants around the Mid-Atlantic. And so June 1st, we opened the office up. We brought people back on a volunteer basis. 2 weeks later, June 15th, we brought everyone back.
Oh, wow.
Who went back. So June 15th. So we've been one of the few businesses, you know, that's been 100% in the office since June in downtown Wilmington. There was actually a Philly Business Journal article written on us 2 weeks ago. And the reason we wanted to do it was we originally thought...
And this show is bigger than that Philly Business
by
Journal.
By far.
I'm joking. Go ahead.
Circulation here.
And
5X.
The cool thing was we really wanted to stress test the protocols of what did it mean to be back at work? Because we figured people would be coming back in the summer. And so we wanted to be a resource that as CEOs and local company presidents were bringing their people back. I wanted them to be able to pick up the phone and say, hey, Chris, what the heck do we do? How do we do this? And so we did things like, you know, we're doing testing in our office every week. We created a school for, you know, the biggest issue we face is parents who've got kids who aren't in school. So we created a little school in our building.
Wow.
It's been conveners. We've partnered with Christiana Care on an app that every day people have to sign into. So there are many different things. We stress test the protocols. And we've been incredibly lucky, I think, and prepared that we've had very little COVID actually in the office, virtually none.
Two cases.
Yeah, two cases since June. So
so it didn't really affect the business.
And by the way, I think first off, you know, end of March, April, May, by then, you know, Rob and I were coming to the office every day, just the two of us, because our wives didn't want us in the house. Right. So we were in the office and then, you know, by June we brought everyone else. But
this is good stuff, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you're enjoying this conversation. It's really fascinating.
So Norman, a couple things. When we did come back, it didn't make sense. I just felt like how do you, as a person that helps run a fairly large business, sit home, work at your desk when you have our frontline people, the people on our construction sites that are actually going there every day to build these great buildings that we have in the city. So that just didn't sit well to me that, you know, we had all of our construction workers working.
Facilities people
operating the buildings, our residential management team. Like, so we have 3,000 people in our buildings in the riverfront in downtown. And you have every day people have to, you know, care for them. So our maintenance team, our engineering team, the leasing team, the management team, the security team. Then you have all the hotels that we have. You know, we have 7 hotels in Newcastle County. And they're, you know, you can't just say, oh, we're going to close down, because you have people there, their houses might have caught on fire. They may have been sick. They might have just moved to the area. You know, you've got news organizations that are covering the presidential campaign. So you can't just say, hey, everyone go home. We'll see you in a year. And so it just didn't sit right with, you know, Chris and I or the other leaders of the company to say, hey, we're That's just going to mail it in from our house. You know, you don't lead from the basement, right? So,
and there was almost like we started to keep the company culture going. Every Friday at noon, we had a company town hall on Zoom, right? And so what I didn't like was all of a sudden there are two classes of employees at BPG. You've got the frontline workers, the facilities people, they're there, and everyone else is sitting in their living room.
How do you keep everybody motivated
now? How do you do that?
How do you keep them motivated?
Well, you know, I think people in our company feel a purpose, right?
Yeah.
And
do you have retreats or anything?
We do a lot around. It's a pretty horizontal company, quite frankly.
We do
days of service. You know, actually, our big retreats are we created a group called BPG Cares, and we go into the community a few times a year, and that's our big bonding teamwork. We're doing a lot throughout the city, but especially with Logan over at the warehouse, We also created DIGS, our diversity inclusion group, as well. So we're outward looking with BPG Cares in the community, and we're inward looking to make sure we're doing all the right things about diversity inclusion with our DIGS team. And we have fun.
We used to do things like movies at Penn Cinema, you know, on a Friday with the whole team, or you know, Constitution Yards. But obviously, COVID's limited that. There's three things that have happened in our portfolio. Our movie theater, Penn Cinema, obviously is getting crushed. Like, not a whole lot of people going to the movies these days. And we're one of the few theaters that have remained open while we've been allowed to be open. The residential population has grown in the city of Wilmington. So unbelievable. We have had our best year ever in terms of our occupancy, our resident satisfaction, our retention rate. So I think what people have seen in Wilmington is, you know, Philly hasn't weathered the pandemic as well. You know, stores are still boarded up. A lot more places have closed down. We've lost a couple of places downtown in Wilmington. Yeah. But compared to other places, John Carney's done a great job in keeping the restaurants and the construction working. So it's allowed us to go forward. You know, Philly, you're still closed. And the restaurants in Wilmington, you know, we go out safely. You know, the transmission rate, I think, in a restaurant's 1.5% is all the data you read. But our hotels have really suffered, suffered.
And
revenue's down in some places 50%.
Wow.
You know, the Hotel de Pont, which caters to lawyers and trial teams, you know, there's just none of that business.
These are the stories that you now hear, ladies and gentlemen. That's why you're tuning
in to the
Community Crossfire. Before you go there, I forgot to ask you guys one quick question, right? We'll come back. We had the unrest in the city of Wilmington, right? We had marchers or rallies and... from the George Floyd or whatever, and downtown got hit pretty hard. Yeah. How did that affect you guys? How did it affect your brand? And looking back, is there anything different you could have done, or you think you've done, did all you could do?
I think, well, Norman, as you know, the night that we had the unrest and broken windows, and I was here from just after it started to, I think I packed up at 5 a.m. after we, you know, finished helping clean up. I will never forget that night. It was jarring, and you realized how we need to do a better job in getting out the message on all the good things that we do. So instead of the Starbucks, you know, for example, place that had the windows broken in, instead of the Starbucks being a place that people thought was, you know, gentrifying, you know, we need to broadcast the fact that the workers in the Starbucks, City of Wilmington people, 90% people of color, you know, so they're the people in there, people that we've hired from the Starbucks that now have gone on to be engineers in our building, in our business. So we didn't, I think as a company, hasn't done a good enough job in getting our message out, all the positive things we've done in the community. So it was very, very unsettling. You know, internally as a company, we realized that we probably didn't do enough to promote all the things that we do for the community. And so that's when we started, as Chris mentioned, diversity and inclusion group, DIGS, BPG. And so we really have spent a ton of time in not just talking the talk, but now doing it. Sarah Lamb and her team in our office have really, I think, spent an unbelievable amount of time so that we don't have to do this. Like, we just, we're going to start on Monday a partnership with again, the warehouse. We're at the Hotel DuPont. We're going to bring, I think it's 30 students that will get training from food and beverage that will be part of the, will be sourced. There'll be, you know, warehouse cohorts, and they'll be working at the Hotel DuPont. So one of the things that really stood out to me was we're in the middle of renovating the Hotel DuPont, right? And we're the green room, which is like the bastion of privilege, right? And you're like, whoa, you know, four doors down, you had windows that were smashed because people were pissed that they didn't feel that they had the same access. So the warehouse partnership where we're actually taking all of these qualified young people that have such unbelievable potential and work with them so that they feel like they own
Incredible.
The green room. And, you know, I think that's the stuff that we really are going to start to do more and more of and promote more and more that we actually
and
do.
And we were doing so, you know, our big focus is the kids in the city and doing so much of the Queen with program for inner city kids in the arts at, you know, Penn Cinema with the movies at the Field House for city kids. But I think what we did was we did a big roundtable that was very emotional in our office about a week and a half after what happened in May. And it was very emotional. We had young people in our office sort of lead it, wow. right? Because it's all about the next generation, right? Because we're getting old now, right? And so we just said, all right, we got to do more and we got to engage more. And so, you know, Rob mentioned that. One of the things we're really excited about is this new program called BPGU. And this is going to be our first summer. We're going to bring in kids from the city of Wilmington into our office, right? So that they're going to have a paid internship in our office. And we're going to start with a few kids this summer just to sort of test it. And then we want to scale it up, but really start bringing kids within our walls. Because again, all these things we do are meant to be aspirational for the kids that live in the city of Wilmington, that they can one day get there. Right. Wow. And so that's our goal, is how do we get these kids who are looking at these buildings, how do we make them feel like they can get there?
Yeah. Because I think our take, and we had explained this to
that's the good stuff, man.
We'd explained this to people in our office. We're like, we every day after school went to Fifth and DuPont. Like, it wasn't like, you know, we were heading out to Hokesson, you know, after school. Like, our parents worked at Fifth and DuPont. That's where we were literally every day. We went to friend's school. We got picked up after sports. Our parents worked till 6-7 o'clock at night. We went down to Lincoln Street to Joe Santillo's, you know, the Italian market there. Like, that was our neighborhood. You know, it looks, actually, Fifth and DuPont looks better than it's ever have if you have been there. So it's not like we grew up, you know, like your children, Norman, you know, going off to Paris. You know, we were, you know, we're so our the way that we looked at ourselves is, hey, we're just like everyone else. And, you know, as we've worked hard, you know, we have that in our head. But, you know, we're in the ivory tower and, you know, the ninth floor of a high rise downtown.
I really think this is an incredible story. I hope people are enjoying it. Like, you know, look, usually do I just sit back and listen to a story? Serious. Yeah. People know that I interject and get in. But, and I know you guys, but I'm enjoying the story. Let's move to now we have Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. Your wife is probably very jealous because you hugging and kissing all the time. Now, these guys are using
their buddies.
I wish. Their buddies, using the Hotel DuPont, the Queen. They're down, you know, then the press is Riverfront, you know. And we got a chance, an opportunity, the city of Wilmington, right? CNN, Washington Post, everybody's here.
This was not in our playbook, right?
Right.
No one expected this to happen.
So like, now we're here. So how do you guys feel? Let's talk about some good stuff.
And Rob said, you know, 2019, we're like, wow, for the first time, we've got 20 years of work and infrastructure. What we've done, we're feeling sort of good about things. COVID hits.
Right.
But, you know, as COVID, as we all get past COVID, to have the international spotlight on like downtown Wilmington.
Wow.
I mean, I don't think any of us appreciated it. It really hit me when someone from the Clinton administration said, you have no idea what this did for Little Rock. Now, Little Rock's in the middle, so that's central Arkansas, right? Wilmington's right in the middle of the biggest population center in America. So the good news is we've got the infrastructure in place to, I think, really take off with the international spotlight now.
Wow. Yeah. Did you want to say anything about that?
No.
This is cool stuff, man.
It's unbelievable. I mean, how surreal is it that that all this is, the government is being formed every day in downtown Wilmington.
Fifth and Market.
Janet Yellen, you know, she's coming, the head of HUD, you know, the head of the energy. Everyone comes to Wilmington
every
to start their career.
Member. Every cabinet
and
member.
And so every cabinet member. So it is surreal. There'll be people from Wilmington that will work in the White House. And, you know, it's cool. The good guy won, right? And Joe Biden, I think, is just so perfect for right now. You know, the unrest that we have today, the unrest that we've had over the past year. I think he's such a good healer. And for, I think, Chris and I personally haven't been so close with the family. You know, I realize some of our leadership skills that we have, just we've gotten through osmosis being around the house. I mean, again, Joe's a guy, self-made guy. And, you know, so I think through osmosis, we're like, well, if he can do that and he can be a senator and he can, you know, run the Judiciary Committee, you know, I think that rubbed off on us a little
bit.
When you know, we're starting our career, because you saw like, hey, this is a guy that is one of the leaders of the free world. And now actually he is the leader of the free world. We're just so grateful to have the friendship.
I hope you guys have enjoyed this interview as much as I have. And in closing, did you want to say something, Chris, or you, Rob, or you say something, Rob? Because this is, I mean, and the folks who are watching, they enjoy this show so much. And I know so many people in Wilmington, around the country, around the world, be watching this. This is Rob and Chris Buccini, the biggest developers right now in the city of Wilmington, state of Delaware. And I'm honored to call these guys my friend. I mean, sometimes we don't do this. We just talk and have fun, you know. And the father's my guy. That's what we should have brought down here. Well, yeah. So, in closing, Chris,
yeah, we should. I'll let Rob close it for us. But you know, first off, Norm, thank you for our friendship. Mm-hmm. We've known you forever now, right. And I just like we spend time together, and I come away energized, and right. and you've always been so true to your heart. Listen, this is Wilmington's time, you know, maybe in a century, in two centuries, right? And I think more importantly that it's Wilmington's time, but it's Wilmington's time for everyone. Mm-hmm. I really see things going on throughout our city. We've got leadership, we've got infrastructure, that I think there's a chance for everyone to really benefit from the city over the next 4 years. So like, we're really excited. We all need to come together and really take advantage of what we got. You know, Rob and I are profoundly, I think, proud. We will look back on our life, everything we've done in our life, and our work in the city will be the thing that we're that much, just the most proud of. And so I think I feel very blessed that when I look back on my life, hopefully a long time from now, I can say I hopefully helped move the needle to make Wilmington the best version of itself.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, and I agree. So we're obviously coming out of a brutal recession, and I think the economy in Northern Delaware and Wilmington has weathered, you know, well, especially compared to our peer cities. And I think it's our time for every corner of the city, you know, the least well-off parts of the city, especially to really now with all the focus on the city and hopefully, you know, the attention that we have here to really grow our way out so that it's a better place for everyone, not just, you know, someone who lives on the riverfront. But I think, like Chris said, it's our time. You know, we have the It's Time campaign, ironically, but it really is. It's the time for every person in the city to make a better life for themselves. And I do believe that in 4 years, we're going to feel a lot better about ourselves than we do today.
Thank you very much, guys. I want to say hi to your mom and dad, some of my favorite people, your children, your wives. I mean, you guys are fascinating guys talking about Fifth and DuPont to what you're doing now. I mean, like you said, you're in a moment now, so you probably can't really enjoy or understand it, but you guys are doing phenomenal work, man,
Thank you, and I'm honored.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed this segment of Community Crossfire, Another Point of View, and I catch you next week in this Storm of Norman. This has been The Big Payback, and I'm out of here like Vladimir. Thank you, guys.
Got to pay back. Revenge. I'm mad. Got to get back. I need some get back.